and got it together.
Can't wait.
And you,
can't wait
that's for what that you got one. To do.
Well, you know what? Our first guest is on the line. So, yes. You know, yeah, how would you like to master the art of living a life of abundance, purpose, and growth that gives you the opportunities to play bigger in the life, the game of life, and experience the fulfillment that you desire and deserve? If you're ready to experience joy, abundance, and wholeness in your relationships, your career, and your day-to-day life, you should connect with Denika Carothers. She is called the Relationship Transformer, and she is on the line now. We're going to welcome her to the show. Welcome to the show, Denika.
Thank you, Will. Hi, Will and friends.
How are you?
Hey.
I am wonderful. Thank you. So grateful to be with you today.
Thank you for coming on. So I was listening to a couple of your interviews on YouTube. I was watching the one where you were talking to the lady about your father. So I do want to ask you about that. But I want to know, first of all, so how are we reflected in our relationships?
Well, you know, who you are, you bring to the relationship. And what a lot of people don't understand is you attract to yourself the things that you are, the way that you think, the way that you process. Your relationships are a direct reflection of you. Mm. And so, you know, whatever you put out into the world is what you give permission to come back to you. And so it's important that people understand that, because, you know, in relationships, you have, you know, you have ups, you have downs, as in life. You have ups and you have downs. Well, one of the things that I know in relationships is that they come into your life for a reason. Mm-hmm. Your relationships serve to teach you, they will test you, they will strengthen you, and they will bring out the best in you if you allow them to.
Mm. I like that. So they will, okay, repeat that. They will test you, they will do what else?
They will teach you, they will test you, they will strengthen you, and they will bring out the best and or the worst.
Good.
So I have a question, because you said that you tracked who you are in that relationship, but what happened to the, I thought about when they say opposites attract, so that just goes kind of against what you're saying. So do you believe in that opposites attract, or you don't?
I believe that let me put it this way. I believe that there is light and that there is darkness, right? And they both serve. So, you know, people might say that darkness is the opposite of light, but they both come from the same place and they both serve. So when you look at them in that respect, then you understand that we attract to ourselves the thing that is ourselves. So that can be lightness and that can be darkness. That can be both at one time, or that can be different things at different times. But one of the things that I've learned is that what you think about, you bring about, you know, and so our thoughts play a huge part in creating our reality. You know, reality is the big word. You know, everybody talks about reality. Well, the reality is, or this is real, or let's keep it real. But our perceptions and the thing that we expect is really the thing that creates our reality. I said, what you expect, you experience.
Mm-hmm.
And in relationships, we have a lot of subconscious programming. You know, there are a lot of things that we operate in that we're not even aware of it. You know, it doesn't present itself in the forefront. So, you know, Will, you said that you saw the interview with my dad.
Right.
When I was talking about my dad. And I actually had an epiphany just yesterday, because I have this thing when it comes to, quote unquote, selling. You know, I hate sales. I hate to feel like I'm selling something to someone. But that's not really true, because I love sharing.
Okay.
But when I was a child, my father used to, quote unquote, force my sister and I to go into the hotels. He was a recording artist. Go into the hotels and sell his products to people that we didn't know. We on spring break, we on summer, we on Christmas break. We just want to be children and have fun.
Right.
And we have to be selling. And so that directly reflected in even my life right now. I just had this epiphany moment yesterday. And, you know, so my father, my relationship with him was a very influential aspect of my life, not necessarily in a good way. That was my perception of it when I was a child. And so I was creating that reality. But when I decided that I was going to change my relationship story with my dad, it had a great impact on my life and my relationships. My relationship specifically with my husband now.
Mm, okay.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
That kind of goes into to the question that I have for you. So can you share with our listeners a little bit about how you made that transformation, or give some tips to our listeners about how to transform that relationship so that you can have a more positive relationship with your mate?
Okay. Well, the first thing that's important is coming face to face with you. You know, we often focus on everything that is outside of us. You know, we identify everything that's wrong in the other person. But you got to look at you, because the only person that you really can change or transform is yourself. And transformation begins with you, and it begins with your mindset. You know, you have to ask yourself, how am I showing up in this relationship? And if I truly am attracting to myself the thing that I am, what do I need to shift or transform within myself in order to be able to create the type of relationship that I truly desire? Okay. So transformation begins with, like Michael Jackson says, starting with the man or the woman in the mirror.
In the mirror.
Being truthful. Yeah, being truthful about who that person is. You know, because a lot of times with this reality, you know, TV now, quote-unquote reality TV, you know, hardly any part of it is real. You know, even with the mirror, we look at ourselves and we don't like what we see, women specifically. So we do makeup, or we, you know, alter this or we alter that, instead of really embracing the truth of who we are. You know, it's okay to enhance who you are, but that's why I don't like makeup, the word make up, because you're literally making up something that is not you. And we, you know, I'm sure you guys tune into these videos now where the person starts off as one look, and by the time they finish with this makeup, it's a completely different person, right?
Yes.
So in our relationships, too, we're afraid to bring the truth of who we are to the relationship. But I always say, you know, who you truly are is going to come out eventually.
Mm-hmm.
But who you truly are, you know who that person is. And so being honest and truthful with yourself is where you need to start when it comes to transforming your life and your relationship.
Go ahead.
That is true, but and listening to you, what happens is that really why you can't really be yourself is because people look at you and are so critical of you, and it really messes with your self-esteem. So that's why you have people have a hard time really being themselves. But once you break that cycle and you get over that, and become fall in love with yourself, then it's an amazing transformation. But you know, when people are looking at you critical, you know, you need to change this, you have a big nose, you need to lose weight, you know. And what I'm finding, because I had another conversation with a friend, it is so easy for people to be so judgmental and really tear you down because they really don't want to see themselves, you know, and what it is that they're doing to you. So it's easier to pick apart like a piece of letters, a person, and break them down, because you really don't want to see yourself. It's easier that way.
Absolutely. And that's why we do that. That's why we are so critical and so judgmental of everything that is outside of us. And we don't want to come face to face with ourselves, because then we got to face the good, the bad, and the ugly.
Right.
You know, so you said something very key just now. You said, when you don't feel comfortable with yourself, you have this experience of people criticizing you.
Right.
And the way that you treat yourself teaches others how they can treat you.
Oh, wow.
And usually the thing that people pick apart about us is the thing that we pick apart about ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
So let's go back to makeup. We were talking about makeup earlier. There was a season when I had really bad cystic acne. You know, I hit like 40 and my body just went crazy. Mm-hmm. I never had any problems with my skin before that. So when it came to how I look, I was good. When I hit 40 and all that cystic acne started showing up, I hated the way my face looked. And so I would put on a whole bunch of makeup because I felt insecure about this aspect of myself. And then when my skin cleared up, I now very, very rarely wear makeup, you know, and usually people will tell you, you need to make yourself up. You need to look more professional. You need to look more polished. But because I embrace the way I look, it really doesn't make a hill of beans, a matter of difference to me, what somebody else feels my face should look like, because I love my face when I look in the mirror.
Mm-hmm.
Different experiences. When I didn't like it, then I took all of that critically, and I took it judgmentally, you know. But when I embraced me, what other people thought about me didn't matter. And, you know, the truth is, if you don't know who you are, you give the world and everybody in it the power to define you, to take away your fineness. And so when you recognize that for yourself by looking in the mirror, then you have the opportunity to refine yourself.
Hmm. Yeah, I'm loving that.
Either define or refine.
Right. Mm-hmm. That is absolutely true. That was a great answer, response. I loved it.
Yeah.
I got to remember that.
So let me ask you a question. So you wrote a book, Who in the Hell Do You Think You Are? And you said that you shared your story about, you know, being left by your husband right after you finished that book. And that I guess there were a couple of lessons that you learned. What are some of the things you can share from that story?
Well, ironically, my husband and I have restored
really
our relationship. Yes, we it's have possible. Restored our That's relationship good. A few months ago. Ironically, but you know, Will, thank you for that question.
You're welcome.
You know what was going on in that season of my life?
Right.
I was shrinking the aspect of who I was to make him feel comfortable.
Mm.
So, you know, it became about him. For me, I began focusing on what you're trying to limit me in, what you're not supporting me and stuff. But I actually was allowing that to happen.
Mm-hmm.
And so often we give people too much power. You know, you can't do anything to me. I allow you to do things to me. The power in that is that when I understand I'm creating it, then I can choose to recreate the situation. And I brought a lot of past stuff, past junk, past thinking, you know, my issues with my dad and feeling judged and feeling criticized. I realized I was bringing a lot of that energy into my present marriage. So it really wasn't about him.
Mm-hmm.
It was about me and what I was allowing in the situation. And when I realized that if I wanted something different, I had to do something different, I began that process to look within rather than without. And like Michael Jackson said, make that change. Yeah, and so who in the hell do you think you are? You know, I always tell people, please make sure you put the in. I ask them, who the hell do you think you are? Who in the hell do you think you are? Because we truly do have the power to create our own heaven in the presence of what might be considered hell. Because the blessing and the curse are the exact same thing. It's your perception of what it is that makes it truth for you.
Oh, wow.
So I choose to focus on blessing.
Okay. Awesome. And where can we get that book from?
You can get that book on Amazon.com, or you can go to my website, www.denikacarothers.com, and you can purchase the book there also.
Okay.
I have a question.
Sure.
Going back to your previous statement, when women, you know, in a relationship, you know, dating or marriage, you know, we end up sometimes losing ourselves, like you said, you know, in our spouse and our husband, you know, giving them so much power, you know, want to be accommodating, and then you end up losing yourself. But once you begin to find yourself again, I think sometimes in a relationship, you know, the man may get intimidated because the woman starts to change because they're really trying to get their power back because they've been lost for so long. And it's very difficult in a relationship for them to adjust, because you find yourself, you're loving yourself, you know, you're feeling free now, you know what I mean? Because you don't have that control over me anymore. So I don't think that, I mean, it puts a strain on a relationship when it really shouldn't, because you got your power back. I found me again because I've been lost for so long.
Right.
And then again,
No.
Go ahead. I'm sorry.
No, you go ahead.
And then, and, you know, another thing I was talking to my friends about, in expectations, I'm learning that there you will find disappointments. So I don't think we should have expectations in it, in one another, because you will find, you know, it's disappointing. But if you accept everybody for who they are, you won't be disappointed. When you put expectations on somebody, that's when the disappointments come in.
Absolutely. You know, I say this, expect without expecting. So you have a right to expect certain things for your life, but don't be attached to how it shows up. You know, and so our relationships come to teach us, you know, and if we choose to learn and grow through the relationships, they can serve you in an amazing way. But I'm sure you guys have heard of this saying. Some people come into your life for a season, And some people come into your life for a reason.
Right.
Mm-hmm. You know, and it's like when you go to school. So you go to college to master something. Once you're finished with that lesson, you graduate. You move on. Not all relationships come to stay forever, you know. And so one of the things that I find is very important, and I encourage my clients with this all the time. If it serves to weaken you rather than strengthen you, it might be time to disconnect from it.
Oh, wow.
Because it is important that you learn to choose you. Because if I don't have it for me, there is no way that I can give it to you. If you need a dollar and I ain't got a dollar, there ain't nothing I can do to help you.
Mm-hmm.
But I have to have the dollar first, right? In order to be able to help you with the dollar. Uh-huh. You know, we become so judgmental as a society, and this word selfish is put out there so much. But I like to use the word self-centered. And I think it is important to center within yourself, because if you don't find that center within yourself, there's no way that you're ever going to find that center with somebody else. You have to first be able to give it to you, because when you give it to you, then you teach me how to give it to you.
Well said. Well said.
Well said.
Awesome. Well, Denika, thank you so much for coming on the show. So can you share how people can follow you again and keep in contact? Because like, you also do like workshops and seminars like that, correct?
Yes, I actually do. I'm actually one of the featured speakers for the Whole Woman Virtual Summit that's going to be this Monday. My topic, I'm talking about the loving mirror, how your relationships reflect back to you, the person who you are. So they can find that information at thewholewomansummit.com. But you can also find me, like I said, on www.denikacarothers.com, where you can follow me on Twitter, Denika Carothers. Find me on Facebook. Denika Penn Carothers is on Facebook, and I'm on Instagram and Twitter, but I don't do too much on those. You know, I haven't gotten into that too deep yet.
Okay.
All the social media.
Where is this summit going to be at this Monday?
It's actually a virtual summit.
Oh,
it's an
wonderful
online summit.
Okay.
Yeah, it's going to be amazing. So I encourage all the women listeners to, you know, plug into that, because we have some pretty amazing speakers who are connected to that.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much for coming on, and have a good evening.
Thank you.
Thank you for having me. Well, you guys too. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
All right. Good information.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was awesome information.
Yes. Okay, so before, because our next guest is going to call almost immediately in, but I want to get this question posed so that you can get your thoughts to go on. So she said a lot of things that I kind of picked up on, and earlier this week, I was having a very intense conversation with myself.
Okay.
That I almost always do. And I was arguing with myself because I was saying that Life Jennings had a song, and in the lyric he said, "Don't be a nickel out here looking for a dime." So I was thinking, like, I go through this thing trying to beat myself, you know, why am I single? Why blah, 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 blah. And then I look at the things that I'm attracted, and I look at the things, not the things, the people that I'm attracted to. Then I look at the people who I guess I attract. Not really happy with all of the people that I attract. Hope you're not listening. But I was just saying, all the things that I'm really attracted to, I'm not myself. Like, still working on my stomach. Really attracted to abs. Highly successful people. I mean, I consider myself to be successful. Not the way I'm going, but a lot of things that I'm trying to work on. So, do you think we have too high of expectations in dating sometimes? Of what we look, because I used to have a very long laundry list of things that I look for in a person. I don't have nearly as many as I have now. You just have to have a job. You don't have to own a whole bunch of stuff now. What?
Wow. Well, that's great. See, I'm not in the dating game anymore.
I think a lot of my things were a lot of superficial things that I can't really see on the air, but I'm not even a lot of those things. So do you have a list of things that your person that you really are strict to sticking to?
Yeah, and I got to hold on to my list.
You got to hold on to it?
I got to. Because I can't settle in love. I'm spending the rest of my life with this person. And I need to be attracted to them physically, emotionally. We have to have similar values.
Are you a big looks person?
Looks is important. I mean, there's some areas that I can work with. You know, because I got some areas you got to work with. So, but you got to be tall. You got to so be taller
if,
than
if,
me.
If a short person showed interest.
I tried. I couldn't do it. Like, I got to look up to you.
Uh-huh.
And you can't physically. Be, yes, and you can't be too overweight.
Uh-huh.
Like, I can deal with a little stomach.
But you yourself said that you did the sugar thing. You were trying to lose weight. So suppose in their mind, you know, I want to lose weight one day.
Uh-huh.
They need to approach you when they lose the weight. Is that what you're saying?
I mean, they can't be. I have to be attracted to them. Like, and I don't think it's I won't say it's just superficial because it's more than just that. Uh-huh. But that's important to me it's at this point in my life.
So I'm not wrong.
Because I enjoy intimacy. Uh-huh. I'm not that old. I like intimacy.
Yeah.
I need to be able to do that. And I can't make it work.
You can't work around a whole bunch of
it
stuff.
It doesn't work for me. I so it's just like you gotta fit.
You see, that's where the wisdom comes in.
So, I mean.
I thought I was reading something. Yeah, okay.
I mean, I'm not in a dating game. You know what I mean? I'm married. I'm not in a dating game. But, you know, that's why I want you guys to remember about that gravity.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? And when that happens to hit, you have to be creative because you can make it do what it do and it will be all right. You know, you understand what I'm saying?
I got the wink.
You got my wink. But the thing of it is that when you get to a certain point, I understand what you guys say about the looks and he has to be this tall. But the thing of it is, great things come in short packages.
I heard.
So the thing of it is that you may have missed out on your king because he wasn't 6'5". You know, you get a 6'5" dude and he's everything that you think that he's supposed to be and he could be a terror.
Mm-hmm.
You understand what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So the thing of it is like you said, you're going to wait for God to send you who you're going to see. You don't know who he's sending you and what kind of package he's going to be in. So that's why you shouldn't put yourself in a, well, I'm not saying you, you know, you shouldn't put yourself in a bubble like that. Mm-hmm. You know, you may meet the guy, he may be overweight, but he might be the best thing since sliced bread. You know, he may be light on his feet and can carry you everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
You understand what I mean? So that would, I have learned that we miss out on a lot of things because of the way somebody's appearance, because you're not really knowing their heart and their mind. But that, again, that comes with wisdom, age, and life lessons.
Mm-hmm.
I'll take it. But I think I got to find out.
I understand what you said. You have to be attracted to them.
And right. I mean, I get that too.
Like, and I have friends who are males who are cool. Like, they are definitely marriage material, but they're just not my marriage material.
Right.
Like,
right.
They're not made for me. And so I think that I really believe that the God that I serve knows my heart. And looks is important, but it's not, like, the first, like, only requirement. You can't
be
sexy and broke and have a bad spirit about yourself and no values.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I don't care how sexy you look. If you don't got the other stuff to go with it, it don't work for me. But I need that to be on the list too for me personally.
Okay.
And I found somebody. So I mean, he looked good. He's tall, and we work. I mean, he older than me, so I switched up on the age.
Okay.
He's a little flexible. But he got his stuff together. He pay bills and he treat me like a queen, and I'm happy. So and he tall.
He's tall.
And it works. I'm attracted. I can do it. You know. So definitely.
Rhea. Raina.
You know, we'll always say somebody's name.
Do you have a laundry list?
Not really.
You seem very high maintenance.
No, if you don't match me, like if you're not as ambitious and as I am, then there's no point.
Now, see, I can get that.
Mm-hmm.
But you're not, you have to be this tall, you have to do this, you have
I'm
to.
Tall, but I'm not, but I'm not.
You know,
as long as you're ambitious and I can see you somewhere down.
You're growing, okay.
Yeah.
See, now, that's
you did
I
good.
Like that answer.
You did good.
Very good.
Yes.
Yeah, go, Nikki.
I see her face.
What she say?
Her face say something different.
Oh, Nikki.
Okay, well, our next guest. She's a friend to our show. She's been on the show last year.
Miss
Laura Richardson. She is lawyer turned life coach. So you can tap into Laura's 13 years experience in dealing with the broad range of problems between people who are in high conflict with one another. Mainly, she deals with a lot of divorces. But she's going to talk to us tonight about the X factor. So please welcome to the show, Miss Laura Richardson. Yes. Welcome to the show, Laura.
Hey, thank you so much, Will. It is a pleasure to be on with you again and
your listeners.
Yes. I just enjoy it so much. Thank you for having me.
You are so welcome. You're so welcome. So let's just jump right in. So I was talking to you, you know, about my situation before, and we were talking about, you know, trying to figure out when you are ready to date again.
Yeah.
I think the first time I did it, I did it too early, and it was a bad decision. It was like a rebound. So when, how can you tell when you are ready to date again after a breakup?
Well, you really should really look inside and really decide whether you have really done the healing that you need. And one of the ways to do that is to really feel like, have you gone through the mourning process? You know, because breaking up, especially if you're coming out of a divorce, it really is equivalent to a death. And if you speak to a lot of counselors, they will tell you exactly that. And there's usually, you know, they'll tell you that there's five different stages of mourning. And so, you know, if you really feel like, you know, you can look back on your relationship and not feel like, you know, a really deep sense of just sadness, kind of overwhelming, just kind of disappointment, those things. I mean, you can look back and say, you know, yeah, that was unfortunate. But if you really feel like you really haven't gotten over it yet, and that's one important thing. The second thing, Will, in that same question is, you know, do you feel like, what are the type of men that you are attracting? Are you still attracting the same type of men that were toxic to you in the first place? And I'll just give you a quick example from my own life. This is a little bit embarrassing, but I'm just gonna lay it bare. Okay. And so I noticed the three men that I was kind of either dating or in a relationship with after my divorce, after the third one, I noticed that they all had something in common. The first thing that they had in common was they were very, very angry. Very angry men. They hadn't healed from their own past, you know, emotional woundings from their relationship. So that's number one. And number two was, which is really odd, they were all very, they had some type of major illness going on. And I believe that in some ways, can't say that it was the start of it, but I think the anger helped whatever illness that they may have had before, they helped it to progress and not in a good place. I mean, I'm talking about really serious stuff. I mean, people who have had, you know, diabetes for a long period of time and now start having nerve damage. Or one gentleman who looked totally healthy to me, Will, absolutely healthy, but he told me then he had liver failure. I'm sorry, kidney failure. And I'm like, oh, my gosh. You know, if he didn't open up his mouth, I would have never known. I mean, so, and I said, oh, my gosh. And the only common denominator is me. I'm like, oh, my gosh, what is it that I'm possibly doing?
Yeah.
Yeah, and so, you know, sometimes what we discovered was I had some ungodly beliefs, some lies that were implanted in me. Some of them were implanted when I was in childhood. Some of them were implanted, you know, during the kind of trauma from my marriage. And they were just, you know, lies that are about myself that I was projecting subconsciously that was kind of sending out a signal, and these toxic men were raising their hands and approaching me. And I'm like, oh, no, we have to work on this stuff. So, you know, so they still might be some, you know, emotional wounds or some things that got implanted that were never supposed to be there that you may need to work on because you're still attracting the same type of toxic guy.
Yeah.
And it's just because I'm in a place that I really still wanted to kind of work on myself. And to be honest, Will, I still am in a place where I am working on myself. And so I don't think that that's, you know, anything to be embarrassed about or ashamed of. You know, it's really a matter of just making sure that you identify, you know, these issues and really split yourself open and start digging. And, you know, because God doesn't want you to take all that crap into your next relationship. I mean, that's the bottom line. And I think, you know, the kind of explosive thing that happened to me last year that really brought that thing to light, and I was able to see, oh, yeah, there's a common thread between these men. And one of the common threads is I'm the only common denominator. So I had to take ownership of that.
Right. So you, so there definitely is a lot of work that needs to be done before you move on. And it's a lot of hard work getting to the root of some of the issues and definitely trying to find out what went wrong, especially like in your situation where you noticed that there was a common denominator and that was you.
Yeah.
Trying to figure out what that baggage is, that thing is. And I don't think I've done that.
Yeah, and that's okay. I mean, even if you're, you know, in the process of doing that, you know, just as long, you know, if you happen to meet up with someone and you happen to say, hey, you know, this is something that I'm really starting to work through.
Mm-hmm.
If they're okay with that, you know, and that they understand that, and you're fairly, you're transparent with that person, then I think that's fine. If that's a journey that they want to, you know, help you along with, then that's fine. I think just as long as they are in a healthy enough place to be someone who is going to be a positive influence and a benefit, and not someone who is going to kind of stir the pot and discourage you from, you know, then doing the hard work that you really are seeking, you know, you're starting out to do. You definitely don't want somebody who's going to derail you and say that's not necessary and blah, blah, blah. And,
right.
You know, all that stuff. So.
Right.
Yeah. Laura, I have a question for you. This is Danielle.
Yeah. Hi, Danielle.
You were talking about how you need to get yourself together before you transition to another relationship. And part of ending a relationship is the grief, but there can also be that bitterness piece,
mm-hmm.
where you're just real bitter because you felt like that person wasted your time. They were not what they said they were going to be. They presented themselves a certain way, and then you realize that they were not that, and
yes.
you have spent that time with them in them years.
Yes.
And you can be bitter for a long time.
Long
I'll tell
time,
you, it took some years to work through that bitterness. And so how would you encourage people to deal with the bitterness factor so that you can continue to move on with your life and meet that person that is for you?
Yes. Move, Jesus.
Danielle and Will, I would say, what you would look at is, for me, what is your definition of forgiveness? And I think some people really kind of get caught up in that. And for me, my definition of bitterness does not mean that, you know, what that person did was good and right. It doesn't mean that I think that I deserve what happened to me. And it doesn't mean that, you know, that there's no consequences for that person. But forgiveness for me just simply means that I give up the right to feel offended and carry that offense any further. But that doesn't mean that that person is then restored back to the same power and position that they had in my life.
Mm-hmm.
You know, sometimes you just need to cut that person off. For some people, where it's a physical safety issue, it means they may have to file charges. They can mm-hmm. forgive and still file charges. You know, people get tripped up by that. It's like, no. You need to file charges. You need to file for divorce. You need to, you know, whatever you need to do to keep yourself safe, keep mm-hmm. yourself sane, then do that. But you can still do that and forgive. You can still sit there and testify against that person if you have to, and still have forgiveness in their heart and still hope that, you know, still speak a blessing over them and hope that they understand, how their behavior was so hurtful so that they don't continue to do that to other people. You know, you pray that they get freedom from whatever, you know, thing that is really kind of tormenting them, if you will. You can certainly still do those things. And it doesn't mean it's not a process. You know, it took me a minute to be able to speak a blessing over my ex.
That was
going to
be my question. Yeah.
With no problem.
Yeah, that was going to be
my question. But, I think, you know, how quickly you forgive can be how quickly you can let go of bitterness and move on.
Okay.
Good, Paula. Hi, how are you?
Hi.
Good. This is Paula. I have a question for you. Why is there so much dysfunction in African American relationships?
Oh gosh. Okay, I'm going to try to give you the short version. the Reader's Digest answer to that one. Okay. okay. Quickly, I think that there's a lot of, from the get-go, a lot of mistrust between men and women. And I think a lot of that, first of all, comes from, if you come from a background that's had some abuse. Now, I can't think of any of my little friends when I was in grade school that didn't at one time or another confess that they were abused in some way, and most of it was sexual in nature.
Mm-hmm.
And so sometimes when that happens, when you grow up into adulthood, you may have a hard time distinguishing or telling which ones are the good guys and are the bad guys. And so sometimes you're just not sure, because usually the people who abuse you when you're a kid, you know, aren't the people who can get close to you. And how can you get close to kids? You know, sometimes you're a family member. Sometimes you're a neighbor that's, you know, that lives very close to where you're living. Or sometimes it's a trusted family friend. You know, so for the people who violate your trust when you're a child, that you're supposed to be the good guys, sometimes when we take that into adulthood, we don't get healing from it, and we take that into our adult relationships, there can be that distrust because you're having a hard time figuring out, you know, who is for you and not against you. Second thing is sometimes, too, if you grow up in a situation where there, you know, there's so much fatherlessness, and, you know, sometimes we can bring that, both for men and women, bring that into relationships where there is a fear of abandonment. And so there's a mm-hmm. lack of trust there. You know, are you going to leave me? You know, am I going to spend this time with you, you know, dedicate my time, my resources, my love, my money, you know, all that stuff, and then are you just going to jump up and leave one day? And you know, just, you know, I'm just going to be broadsided by it. And so, you know, I think those two major things are just so pervasive, especially in the African-American community. You know, this is, from the get-go, a lack of trust. And the second thing is, I think the dysfunction, especially for women, there is this panic, or what I consider a panic, and that is a lot of women of color think that there is a small pool of eligible men that they have to choose to date and marry. And they feel like, you know, there is that, you know, smaller pool, especially if they're limiting themselves to black men, then, you know, they feel like there's so much more competition.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, there is sometimes this rush to get into a relationship. And sometimes we get into relationships with people that we are not really compatible with. We'll blow through these red flags because we feel like, oh my gosh, I really don't have a large, you know, I don't really have a whole bunch of choices anyway.
Mm-hmm.
And okay. So, you know, oh my gosh, you know, yeah, I'll look past, you know, that, you know, he's, you know, doing whatever that, you know, is really bugging me, but, you know, whatever, I'm just going to keep it moving and pray that. And the thing is, too, I think what a lot of women do, which I don't think is fair at all, they think that they can change a man. And,
well, you
know, they'll blow
that.
Through these red flags, and they'll say, you know what, you know, they're so used to seeing a single, you know, female-headed household, you know, hey, you know, they may be raising, you know, a young boy themselves, and they'll look at their relationship more as a parent-child relationship instead of a relationship between two mature adults that are supposed to be, you know, equal, you know, co-laborers or, you know, helping one another, you know, helpers to one another. And they'll say, you know what, just like I'm training up my son, I can train up my boyfriend,
mm-hmm.
you know, to get him to do what I want him to do. And I think that's so unfair because, you know, unless he says, yeah, you know, that I know that I have these character flaws that I need to deal with, and that, you know, if you don't mind walking this out with me, then fine. But, you know, if he doesn't, you know, if he, from the get-go, he doesn't really see what he's doing as a problem, you think you're going to change him, you're setting yourself
not
up for
like
failure.
Right.
So, yeah, that is, I think, a lot of the dysfunction that's going on, especially in the African-American community.
Hmm.
And so, you know, for me, I would say, especially for women of color, if you feel this sense of panic, I would say, you know, expand your horizons or what you would really find as attractive, you know, to beyond your own people group. And, you know, for example, I date black men. I think they're gorgeous, sexy, hunky, all that good stuff, and they have a whole lot to offer. But I don't limit myself to black men.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's a whole lot more that I find that is attractive. You know, for me, I am a believer. And so first and foremost, I want to know how you feel about Jesus, and then mm-hmm. we'll kind of go from there.
Okay.
And I don't really care what your skin color is.
I was reading in another one of your blogs, I think you were saying how you were being patient for God to send you your mate, and you were working on yourself.
Yeah.
So I know for me that has people always say this is the time, you know, time for you to work on yourself. And I'm like, I never got what that is. So what's been your experience with coming to grips to that is what you need to do, and what is working on yourself? What does that mean? Work on yourself.
Well, I think that's an excellent question. Thank you. I think a part of that, or a major part of that, is really discovering, you know, if you haven't already, what is it that makes your heart beat faster? And that could mean, that could, you know, steer you in the direction of your career,
mm-hmm. okay.
You know, maybe enhancing your career in some way, you know, mm-hmm. maybe going back to school mm-hmm. and, you know, maybe getting a master's or something like that, so that way you'd be able to, you know, go to that next level in your career, mm-hmm. or maybe some for some people it is going to something that may be somewhat similar career, but maybe kind of switching gears a bit. For some people, that's also, you know, I mean, for me, it was both personal and career-wise. And I had kind of just been in this season of just being really, really unhappy as a practicing lawyer. And I really just had to really pray about it really hard and just ask and seek wisdom from God and say, you know, what is it that's really going to make me happy? And that's really how I kind of got into this life coaching thing. And to be honest, I really prayed this out for about 2 years before I actually really started making the steps to then switch over. Mm-hmm. So that's a part of it, and really preparing your heart to do that. And a lot of that for me was just really learning to go up to that, you know, that quiet place with the Lord, because, you know, there aren't a whole lot of examples out here for me to look at. And so for me, it really had to stretch my faith mm-hmm. in that, you know, as Tony Robbins says, get on the island and burn the boat. And trust me when I tell you, I got on the island and burned a boat, and there is no safety net here, folks. And so it's pretty scary out here sometimes.
Right.
You know, there is sometimes a sense of, you know, even anybody coming out of a divorce or, you know, just a breakup for you in one period of time where you've had a lot of, you know, financial entanglement with one another.
Right.
You know, there is that financial insecurity, mm-hmm. you know, and there are times, you know, where I'm just not hitting my goals for the month, mm-hmm. and there is financial insecurity. And, you know, and so that's a part of it, you know, being in that place where you are just getting centered and focused, and, you know, no matter what's, you know, you may feel like you're surrounded by enemies that are barking threats around you, but, you know, you just have to keep your eyes, you know, looking above. And so that's a part of it. Really, what does that personal growth look like when you are under stress and pressure and you feel like you're being pressed to the floor? What does that look like? You know, and how do you react to it? What are you going to do to react to it?
Mm-hmm.
Are you going to, you know, like I used to do before when I was younger, I used to have panic attacks when I was in law school. I mean, literally hyperventilating. I mean, breathing into a paper bag.
Wow.
You know, my hair starting to shed and fall out. Stuff like that. You know, how are you going to react differently?
Mm-hmm.
The second thing is, you know, for personally, you know, some of the other stuff that, you know, trying new stuff. Now, for example, I just transitioned to a new church, and I said, you know what? I am going to attend a messianic service and see if I like it. And sure enough, well, you know what? I liked it and ended up being on the dance praise and worship team. So now I'm on the dance team for the messianic ministry. And I never would have known I would have liked that unless I tried it.
Right.
And so different stuff like that, that's what it really looks like in the waiting. You know, when you're waiting and you feel like, you know, you're asking, you know, Lord, how can you prepare me for, you know, to receive the love, you know, and attention of the person that you're preparing for me? And also, too, being at a place where you can pray for that person, even though you may not know who that is.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm praying for my future husband, and I believe I have not met him yet.
Mm-hmm.
Lord, do you encourage, like, casual dating? I'm not talking about intimate dating. I'm talking about casually, if you are leaving from church and someone invites you out to coffee during this time where you're working on yourself. Is that something you should be doing, going out to coffee, or should you fix those issues you're working on and then begin the process of meeting people casually and then determining, is this God sent or is this not the right time?
I think it's okay just as long as you're at a place where, you know, your conversation, your everyday conversation with people is not really just kind of toxic and focused on, you know, all the things that went wrong with mm-hmm. your last relationship. Now, I'm not saying, you know, if that person asks you a very, you know, specific question, yeah, you know, be, you know, honest, you know, to a degree. Obviously, you know, you don't want to pepper that person with, you know, again, all the bad stuff if they ask you a question. But, you know, in a sense, you can answer that question in a way that, you know, okay, you know, you're just meeting this person, so, you know, you can be candid to a point where, you know, you still don't really know this person. So, you know, if you're at a place where you feel like you're comfortable, that you feel like you can, you know, really benefit and enjoy the company of another person,
mm-hmm.
and you feel like you've done enough healing, you know, you're not still at a point where you might be going home and crying every night, you know, stuff like that. You know, if you feel like you're on the other side of all the hard stuff, I guess that's the best way to put it. And sometimes, you know, it's just a gut feeling that you have. you know, sometimes it's not really a, you know, 5-point list that you're checking off to say, yeah, you're ready. You know, it really is that, you know, what we kind of talked about a little bit earlier about the healing and about just knowing. One other thing, too, was I found out last year that I still had a lot of embarrassment, shame, and disgrace about some of the things that happened in my marriage. Mm-hmm. And even some of the things that moving further on, you know, in a relationship, say, for example, I found someone that I decided that I wanted to date them exclusively. Would I then, you know, have trouble talking about what happened? And I found out that I did. So then I knew that for me in my gut, okay, I'm not quite ready yet. And so those types of things.
That you knew that you weren't quite ready to date, you meant?
Correct, yes. Oh, I wasn't quite ready to date.
Because you weren't ready to talk about that. Okay.
Yeah, I still need to work through some of that hurt. Ah, I mean, that's the way that the light got shined on that particular problem, and I still needed to work on that.
Okay.
That's how I knew. So certain things, you know, will get exposed and be like, oh, you know what? I didn't really think about that. You know, I'm still may not be ready yet.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Well, awesome. Thank you for this information. I have one final question, and it's just based your opinion on something. So to go back to the working on yourself, so you're like, it could be a good time to go back to school to further your career, possibly if you want to get into exercising, whatever. Do you think all of this is in preparation to also help you appeal to a different type person?
I think for me to attract that emotionally healthy and spiritually mature person that I want to be in relationship with, mm-hmm. I want to be able to mirror that back. In other words, a lot of people say, become the person that you want to date.
Exactly. Yeah. That's on my wall. Yeah.
Yes, and so you know, you definitely you want to do that. So in other words, you know, if I'm expecting that guy to be, you know, financially stable and really got his head on straight, you know, am I going to mirror that back? You know,
exactly.
And it doesn't have to be perfect, but if you're really working on that, you know, if you're setting out a budget, if you're paying down your debt, mm-hmm. you know, you may not be right where you want to be right now, but just as long as you're working it and you have a plan, I think those things are important. So those are all the things that you can kind of think about as you're working on yourself.
Okay.
You know, are you mirroring those things back that you want to see in that person that you want to date?
Awesome. Well, thank you so much. How can people follow you?
Yes, they can find me on my website at howtomoveonafterdivorce.com.
Okay.
Or I am all over Facebook. And you can be at facebook.com/ Laura, L-A-U-R-A dot Diane, D-I-A-N-N-E dot Richardson.
Mm-hmm.
And they can also find me on Instagram at Laura_D_Richardson.
Wow. Well, thank you so much for coming on the show. And we'll of course, have you on in the future. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, ladies. Thank you so much.
Have a
thank
great
you,
evening.
Will.
All right. Have
thank
a good night.
Too. Good night.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
All right.
Okay.
So, I don't know if I'm ready or not.
Are you're not sure if you're ready or not?
Who knows?
I think we had this conversation before.
We have it over and over and over again.
Over and over and over.
When
again.
I leave here, I'll be strong and I'm ready. Then I'll argue with myself and say, no, I'm not ready. I just don't know.
You're putting yourself on a struggle bus unnecessarily.
Just enjoy life. Like,
what does that mean?
What does what mean? The struggle bus or enjoy life?
Like, find some stuff you like to do and just meet
alone?
People. Like, I'm cool with going out alone. Everybody doesn't like that. I have a twin sister who hates going out by herself. But
what can you do alone, though?
Oh, I can have a good time.
Really?
Yes. I have went on trips by myself.
Trips?
Yes. Trips by cruises. Danielle.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
Met some sexy chocolates. You just be smart with it, you know.
Oh,
I won't like wander by myself to get kidnapped, but I stay with crowds of people. I engage, I mingle, I pay attention to my intoxication levels when I'm going back wherever I need to go. But I meet people, I have a good time, build relationships with people. And you might find that somebody while you're doing that, you know. But just sitting saying, oh my God, I got to work on me and woe is me. And that sucks. Go have some fun.
Well, I'd be having some fun, but
I can't stand it. But you know,
all right, you know what?
She's right though. You know, I enjoy, which I always thought that I had to be, was hang out with somebody, but I enjoy being by myself, going to, I went to the movies by myself. It was a weird experience. The first time I did it, it was kind of weird. And then when I went out to eat by myself, I was feeling weird as well, because I'm like, I want everybody just looking at me thinking that I don't have any friends.
I don't have a problem
and
going to eat by myself.
But I you know, now I can do it, and it's cool. I'm comfortable with it, because I'm comfortable with myself. You know what I mean? I'm comfortable being with myself and dating myself. You know, hanging out with me.
You seem so social, Will. Like, he, you could go social into some place, you're a social butterfly, and sit down at the bar and just chat it up with people.
Girl, I would be behind the bar, backed up against the wall.
You need an alter ego. I am good. Like Sasha Fierce.
This is my
just
stage.
Come on out and bring
this
it.
This is my stage in which I operate in my alter ego. But now, when I'm at home, Paul will tell you I'm a homebody. She has to tell me this is what we're, like, tomorrow, she's like, we're going to this event.
Yeah, we're going to the event.
I'm fine going to work, coming home, and...
No,
my house is comfortable. So
right, we're going to an event. Like, he gets mad at me because we go to our meetings on, what is it, once a month, the Hampton Roads Black Media Professional Group. And, you know, I'm chatting with everybody. And he's like, come on, let's go. I'm like, no, because.
The meeting's adjourned. She went to go hug everybody. I'm like, this ain't church.
That's what he said. But that's me, you know, because nobody's a stranger to me. Right, but. You know, you have to present yourself as being friendly. You know what I mean? And that's how you get to meet people and make relationships. You have to talk to them. You can't just be like, okay, I'm out, or I'm standing way in the corner. And you're like, well, you better hurry up because you about to get left because I want to engage
still,
with people.
That's still the truth, though.
What is still the truth?
One day I think you're just going to have to get left and you will know. Yeah. What's your question?
I have a question. Relationship question.
Sure.
Okay. Recently someone asked me this and I never thought about it. Do you think, or do you feel, or have you ever experienced someone judging you based on your previous relationships, the type of people you've dated before or married before or been involved with? Have you ever been judged by the caliber of person that you had a previous relationship with?
I'm going to say yes.
So, in other words, have you ever been accused of dating down or out of your class or out of your league?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's
no
not
one?
Right.
No, I mean, it isn't right. But, I mean, you shouldn't be... I mean, this is so weird that everything that is happening today is a conversation that I've had in the last couple of days. Mm-hmm. But I don't think that you should be judged on your past or who you've dated in the past. Right, but you shouldn't, because... First of all, they don't want it to be done to them, but it's okay for them to do it to you. And what happened in my past is in my past. It has nothing to do with my present or my future, you know, because what I've learned in my past is a life lesson. You understand what I'm saying? So this is just phenomenal that we're having this conversation because, you know, we have dated down, you know what I mean? And we have, you know, I've dated somebody. Right. By somebody else, like, you know, one of my husband's favorite sayings is that he's probably going to kill me, is that, man, I can't believe you dated that foul ball.
Exactly.
You know what I mean? I was like, seriously? But who's saying that the person that you dated was just some queen or some, not, you know, I just can't believe it. I just can't believe it. You know, and I'm like, why would you say that? You know what I mean? Because he's this, he's that, he's this, he's that. But, you know, again, you know, like you said, by whose standards? You know, you're saying that the dude is a foul ball, you know what I mean? And then, but you're saying that, you know, of course, they always going to be like, now you got the best thing since peanut butter and jelly since sliced bread. Because you got me, you know what I mean? Everybody else is a foul ball. So, I mean, I get what it is that you're saying, but it's wrong to do that to me.
Okay. So, our next guest is on the line. And so, I was in... I don't know where I was at, but I saw this magazine called The Advocate. And there was on the cover it said, "Stop Shaming Black Men." So I went to the article to look for it, and I was just stunned by the opening line of it. It was like, one in two black men, black, gay, or bisexual black men, will become HIV positive within their lifetime. And I was like, wow, that's me or my friend. And it really shocked me. So I did whatever I had to do to hunt down our final guest for tonight, Jacob Anderson Minshall, I believe I'm saying that right, is the senior editor at the Advocate magazine. And I just invited him to come on the show to talk to me, number one, about his research, because the CDC at a conference last year, they released a lot of surprising statistics. And when I talked to him, he was like, if nothing is done, this could be the case for black men. And it really it opened my eyes. So I want to welcome to the show Jacob Anderson-Minshall. How are you doing?
I'm doing good. Thanks for having me on.
No problem. So, again, like I was saying, I read your article, well-written article. The facts just blew me away. So I knew I definitely had to get you into, get you onto the show. So you're a senior editor with The Advocate, the nation's largest running LGBT news magazine and Plus magazine. So can you tell me a little bit more about Plus?
Yeah. Plus is the nation's most widely read magazine for people who are living with HIV and then people who help them in various ways or who are partners. And we're available in print, and we provide free bulk subscriptions to any HIV organization or service provider that wants them. And then we're also online at HIVplusmag.com.
Oh, okay.
All right. I noticed that the CDC, the Center for Disease Control and Prevention, they released lifetime predictions about who would get HIV. What did they find exactly in those predictions?
Yeah, they found that, you know, some groups still have much higher risks of becoming HIV positive than other people. And, for example, if you look at heterosexual American men, the lifetime risk for them of getting HIV is 1 in 473.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But for men who have sex with other men, the number is 1 in 6.
Wow.
And then the numbers get worse if you're a person of color. So for Latino, gay, and bi men, they have a 1 in 4 chance of becoming HIV positive in their lifetime. And as Will was saying earlier, black, gay, and bi men have a 1 in 2 chance of becoming HIV positive.
Wow.
And that's really, it's so scary because, again, you're talking about if they were, you know, a young gay and black, you know, bisexual youth of today, that they are looking forward to 1 in 2 chance in their lifetime is frightening.
Hmm.
Well. So, we were having a conversation earlier, and I'm just going to be just transparent. Why is it that the focus is always on black men, that they have a higher chance to get to become infected with HIV? It's always like, you know, the black person or the black male has a higher expecting rate to become HIV positive, or we have a higher expecting rate to be plagued with diabetes or heart disease. You know, why is it just a focal point on black gay men and not white men? I mean, what's the difference? I mean.
Yeah, absolutely. There are a lot of factors that have played in the fact that the black community has higher rates of HIV than the white community does. And that includes things like poverty, discrimination, lack of access to health care, and stigma around HIV, you know, testing and getting treatment.
Mm-hmm.
But that's one of the, you know, what we're trying to look at is really see, well, what is it specifically that is different in these communities? And I had talked to Dr. Neil Goldstein. He's with Drexel University at Philadelphia about this. He's been looking into this for a long time. And he sort of like looked at all these different influences that impact black communities. And ultimately, he thinks some of the difference comes down to what he calls social sexual networks. These are kind of the networks that we date in and find sexual partners in.
Mm-hmm.
And he's pointing out, you know, race still really impacts our potential dating pools. I mean, even today, people tend to be more likely to date within their race than outside of it. And so being members of a minority, African Americans already have smaller dating pools than the white community. And because you're in a smaller dating pool, HIV can travel around that pool faster.
Mm.
And then over time, those smaller pools kind of continually raise HIV rates because you're bumping into each other faster in a smaller space.
Okay.
So that's really the bottom line. It's because black community is a smaller community and because it has these disadvantages that then get, you know, sort of rebounded over time because of discrimination and lack of access to health care. It just kind of keeps snowballing in a way that it doesn't in the white community.
Okay. Yeah, I hear what you're saying, but I disagree with your saying. okay. Absolutely. I absolutely disagree with what you're saying, because today there's a lot of free healthcare out there and free resources for people to get condoms. People are our database, you're saying that what you're saying is that in the African-American community that there's a small dating pool, and in today's society, you know, people are dating outside of their race more and more. You know, I see, you know, you have black men, I see black men with white men, Asian men. So I totally disagree with that, especially in this time, because people are dating anybody they want to date. It is, really doesn't pertain to color anymore, especially in the gay community. So I'm totally disagreeing with that. That's just like putting black gay men in a box. I don't agree with that.
I totally hear you.
You know, I think that's totally wrong, because that's not what I see. And yeah. I know that there's so much health prevention out there for people that don't have insurance. You know, they're given, you know, even drug addicts, they can go places and get free needles. So I'm disagreeing with what you're saying.
Yeah, I think you're very right. Things are totally changing. And I think part of what we have to just remember is that HIV has been hitting the United States for decades now, or mm-hmm. over three decades. So many of the things that have made why HIV is the way it is in America have been happening since that time. So it has just, you know, these things are the way they are right now, but they're the way they are right now because of decades of, you know, how people interact with each other. So, but you're right, absolutely. Today, we have greater access to prevention, greater access to treatment than ever before. And that's the great news, because that's the part to focus on. Because what they said when the CDC did this study is, if things don't change. But you know what? This is a cry for us to change it. We have to change it. And we are already changing. So that's the amazing thing. It you know, can sound like, because of those rates, it can sound like it's harder, that it's sort of like easier than ever to get HIV, and it's just simply not true. And we have these great ability to, like, prevent HIV now in all these great ways. So.
Right. And you know, I'm glad that you said that, but I think that the focal point doesn't just need to be in the black community, and the focal point doesn't need to be just on the black gay guy, because it's always that way, and it is putting them in a box, and it's plaguing everybody in every race and every nationality. So I think that they just need to look at it in a broader perspective, and not just the gay black man, and making them out to be that they're the most promiscuous race ever. I think that that's not fair. And because you put a panic, you know what I mean? You make it put the black gay man in a panic almost, because the focal point is always on them.
Yeah, I mean, why I wrote this was in response to two things. One was the study itself coming out and saying one out of every two black gay men. And we do know rates are higher among black gay men than they are among white gay men.
Mm-hmm.
But the reasons, and you talk about promiscuity, and that is one of the things that always comes up, is this is the argument I hear. I hear that there's a presumption that the black community is more homophobic than other communities.
Yes.
This is a presumption. Studies are actually suggesting that's not true.
Mm-hmm.
But people say it's true.
Mm-hmm.
And then they say, well, since growing up gay in a homophobic environment is difficult, black gay men have low self-esteem. And because they have low self-esteem, they do risky sexual behavior and drug use.
Mm-hmm.
So they have more sex with men, and they are drug users. But that's not true. I mean, that's what studies keep showing, that black men are actually less likely to have unsafe sex, less likely to have numerous partners, and far less likely to use drugs than white gay men. So that's part of, like, the motivation for doing this story, is that we're we are hearing these stories about black gay men that are repeated a lot, but they're just not true.
Okay. So it sounds like the statistics are like apples to oranges, because we are taking a small population of people, a community of people, and looking at their numbers in comparison to a different population of people and coming up with the number of how many individuals are going to potentially contract HIV. Would that be accurate?
Well, no, they do. I mean, somewhat. I would say that in somewhat you're absolutely right, because that's one of the things that Dr. Goldstein was making a point of, is that sometimes we compare the wrong people.
Mm-hmm.
So, for example, even when we compare rates of HIV, we often do compare white gay men and black gay men. And really what we should compare is black men and black gay men, because... Right, the numbers are actually quite different. When you compare white gay men and white straight men, white gay men actually have higher rates of HIV compared to straight men than black gay men do compared to black men. So it is absolutely about who we look at, who we're comparing to. But definitely what CDC did, they certainly looked at what the rates were in a variety of groups, and part of their point is just they're trying to say, again, I think they release these numbers to shock people into action.
Yeah,
and they're trying to do that where the numbers are the most shocking, and here's where the numbers are the most shocking. I mean, unfortunately, the numbers are really the most shocking when it comes to trans women of color, but they don't keep good records on trans women of color, so they can't tell us a prediction, but their rates are even higher. So, but again, I think this is absolutely, we're doing this, they said it, we talk about it, in order to keep reminding people that this doesn't have to be the outcome, and we have ways to stop this from happening.
Right. So Jacob, myself, I'm not necessarily disputing or even trying to ask why is black men. I think just personally from a personal experience and just having a group of friends and being in the community, I do see a high rate of black gay men who have HIV and AIDS, whatever. But my question to you is, some of the reasons that I feel, and I've had conversations with friends about why I've seen like a lot of younger people in my community who have it, and we were trying to come up with reasons why this is the case. And I came up with a solution that I feel like, because a lot of people are saying, you know, are promoting the fact that it's treatable now, or it's downgraded or whatever to a critical illness, or, you know, there's so many treatments that you can take, you can live a full life, that people are just, they're just not, it's not as serious, or it's not as perceived as such a serious illness as it was back, 10, 15 years ago.
Yeah.
And then, like you were saying, the homophobia in our community. I'm not sure how it is in the Latino community or the Caucasian community, but definitely in the African-American community, homophobia is alive and strong, especially when you get into the church community. So I myself have encountered people who are on the down low in the church, and I was shocked to when something was going to be intimate and they weren't going to be protected. They were trying not to be protected. So I think both of those factors do play a role in why our statistic is so high. I'm still surprised either one out of two, but I do believe that it is high. I've seen that for experience myself, that we have a high. But I wanted to ask you, so your article was entitled "Let's Stop Shaming Black Men." Why is that?
Yeah, and I think that at bottom line it comes down to, because black gay men are not sluts. I mean, we act a lot like we say this stuff as though black gay men just need to stop having so much sex, or they just need to stop having sex with so many people, and that's not the issue. The issue, again, if that was the issue, then we would have higher rates among white gay men, because white gay men continue to have more sexual partners, more unprotected sexual acts, and more use of drugs with sex at the same time than black gay men have. So those are obviously not, like, the causes of these things, and we need to stop acting like they're the cause. Again, the causes are you're in a small group of people, you keep repeating this stuff, it's very easy for something to continue to get transmitted. And We do know that people aren't using protection. Again, that's across the board. People are not using the same kind of protections that we used to.
Yeah.
But that's why things now, it's why it's so great, because really, truly, we are in a moment where things are changing revolutionarily. You know, we have for so long, the major way that we've been able to talk about prevention in transmission is by saying you have to wear a condom. That's the only way you can prevent transmission. We don't need to say that anymore. Mm-hmm. We have medication known as PrEP. It's proving to be 98% to 99% effective. And right now it's a one-a-day pill, but later this year we're going to start seeing some other options, and that includes things like long-acting injectables. You get a shot every few months, and it helps prevent HIV from transmitting. Mm.
So,
and then we also know that these, like, if we can get you into treatment and get your viral load under control, that's with the sort of these counts of the virus. So if we can get the virus down undetectable, which if you get on treatment, you can do, then you're no longer able to transmit HIV to your partner. And I mean, I say unable, and I mean that after years of monitoring thousands of couples where one person is HIV positive and the other isn't, there have been zero cases where HIV has been transmitted when the positive partner is undetectable.
So, I'm sorry, I keep hearing a lot about the PrEP.
Yeah.
So that is that's a pill. It's like a prevention.
Right now, right now, the PrEP is actually the anything that does this prevention is going to be called PrEP.
Okay.
Right now, the only thing that's been approved for it is Truvada, which is a pill, and you take a pill once a day, and you don't get HIV.
Oh, okay.
And there have been several people who've gotten HIV on PrEP, but that is out of, again, thousands, tens of thousands of people who have been taking it. And in all but one case, they found that the person wasn't maintaining the medication at the level they were supposed to.
Okay.
So, yes.
For the medication, how much access does our community have to that medication? Because when you think about meds, like for instance, I'm not in the community, but like I have heart disease, and my medications are very expensive. And so, if I don't carry good insurance and I don't have the income to cover the cost of the medications, then I don't get to get it. So, how affordable is this medication? How available is it to the community to help them?
Yeah. The you know, right now, the biggest barriers is not actually price. It is actually getting doctors who will prescribe it and getting doctors who will tell their patients about it.
Mm.
And here's why it's not about price. It can be expensive. But right now, Truvada, it is produced by Gilead. Gilead is doing PrEP copays. Well, they will help you with your payment. If you are on insurance, they'll help you meet the insurance gap. They will help you if you aren't on insurance. And literally, we've had people go through this, and they've gotten it for free.
Wow.
And it's taken them about 5 minutes to go through the enrollment process.
Wow. Is this...
This is through Gilead, and it's G-I-L-E-A-D, and it's their co-pay program. And, yeah, they can get that. So the main thing, again, is finding a doctor who will prescribe it. Mm-hmm. And a lot of any doctors who do HIV testing or who are providing HIV treatment will provide it. And otherwise, you can just ask your primary care physician, you know, to prescribe it.
Oh, okay. Well, that answered my question then, because I thought I was going to ask you, was it an investigational medication, but... Since you're saying that.
Not anymore.
Okay.
Yeah, no, it's definitely gone through all the process. It's been approved for multiple years now. It's actually, the drug itself originally is a treatment for HIV, and then they were just able to find that it would work also as prevention. So it's, you know, we have long years of people using it as well, so it's not one of these drugs where you're not sure what might happen. We know the kinds of side effects it has, et cetera.
Okay.
And again, they're doing... there's a whole bunch of new ones that are going to come up soon, including, like I said, there's a number of long-acting injectables. Mm-hmm. Some of them are going to just be like every other month, and then they are working currently on some that would be more like once every 6 months to a year. Mm-hmm. And that would be all you'd have to do to have a prevention.
Okay.
But still no closer to a cure.
No closer to a cure, but we, again, preventing is a huge, huge change. And we really, truly, if we can get you into treatment quickly, mm-hmm. we can. Now you can have the same lifetime, you know, you will have just as long and just as healthy of a life as somebody who is not on HIV treatment.
Wow.
So, I mean, you know, sorry, somebody who doesn't have HIV. It, so long as you, you know, if you are the person with HIV and you're in treatment and you maintain your treatment, you really, your life expectancy will not go down because you're on HIV treatment and because you're HIV positive. So we have already reached an amazing place, and we are getting closer to what they call a functional cure, which would mm-hmm. be treatments that they can give you where you basically go into remission for long periods of time.
Oh, wow. Okay.
I want to speak to something Will said, and I have a question that goes with it. Because yep. he talked about the younger community who seem to have HIV. And I spend a lot of time working with youth and young adults. And I've come across a lot of clients who are young, who are openly bisexual, and they understand that if they contract the disease, that they can live with it. So it seems like... Yeah. The idea of the disease has changed, and it's went from I don't want this because I can die to if I get it, it's okay, I can take a pill and live. Have you seen a transition in how individuals perceive HIV now, especially for the younger population of individuals?
Yeah, you know, I hear this a lot. I do hear it a lot. I haven't seen it play out in studies that they've done, but mm-hmm. I definitely continue to hear that people... You know, and this is always, I think, it is the hard thing to be able to say, on one hand, we want to say, we want to get rid of the stigma around HIV. So we want to assure people you can still live happy, healthy lives with HIV. That doesn't mean you want it, though. Like, this is this, I think we have to just keep treating it sort of like diabetes.
Mm-hmm.
You can live, you know, happily with diabetes. But it will change your life. You will have to eat different things. You mm-hmm. will have to exercise differently. And it may leave you open for other kinds of issues and diseases and health problems in the future that you wouldn't have if you didn't have it.
Mm-hmm.
So we still want people to not become HIV positive.
Right.
We certainly did experience, definitely there was a period, and this is why I'm worried about this number that we keep talking about, the 1 in 2. We have definitely experienced in the gay community before where young gay men were so sure that they were going to become HIV positive that they didn't want to even bother taking efforts to not become HIV positive because
mm-hmm.
They felt like they were doomed to it, right?
Yeah.
So that's the one thing we have to make sure we're not saying when we repeat this number and tell young black gay men you have a 1 in 2 chance of becoming HIV positive, because I'm already hearing from people in the community that are like, well, why am I bothering?
Right.
And that is not the message. The message, again, is supposed to shock us into saying we are not going to let this happen. So we can't just go, oh, well, that's going to happen anyway. Let's go ahead and let it do it.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you, Jacob, so much for all this information.
Yes, thank you.
Yes, I really appreciate you coming on the show. I really do.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Have a good evening.
You too.
All right. Bye-bye. Okay. All right. Y'all okay?
Yeah, I needed fine. The information. I learned quite a bit. It was very helpful.
I learned quite a bit.
There's still very a stigma interesting. Surrounding it, though. There's still a stigma.
Yeah.
Even if, I guess they're the prep, if you take that, you won't get it. You said 98%, something like that?
Right? Yeah.
Yeah.
Those are great statistics.
So I wonder why there needs to be, well, I'm sure our president, he's going to, if he's getting rid of Meals on Wheels, he's not going to make that sometime.
Oh, no, yes.
That's nowhere close to priority.
Yeah.
And I think that I think the focus needs to be more on, like, the information he gave us about the PrEP and the injections.
Yeah.
More so than the statistics, targeting a certain ethnic group.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? And
that's what I don't see it as a target. It just... I don't know what the pool was that he studied. I don't know what the demographics were, but evidently it was presented at the CDC conference. Yeah. So there had to have been some type of an official study. It wasn't like an attack on our community.
Maybe I used the wrong word.
Yeah, it's not a racial statement. Mm-hmm. It's just the fact that our community, the Black community, the gay and bisexual community, had a higher rate.
But there,
so that's the prediction if nothing changes.
Right, but I think what he said to when I heard him speak, he stated that it was in the low income area. He didn't say overall. Oh. He was saying he was saying that that's what I'm stating. Mm-hmm. You know, they're only targeting one area. Mm-hmm. You know, and then in that area
to make a general statement.
Right. Yeah. And so he backpedaled after I said what I said to him. He changed his story because he knew that I was correct. You know, I'm not agreeing with what you're saying. You know, there's a lot of people that I know in the community that are smarter now. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Even in the low income area, they're smarter because they want to be healthy. Mm-hmm. So it's not to say that everybody's just running amok and just having unprotected sex. You can't say that anymore. You see what I mean? Because I have read some information in a magazine. Ironically enough, they're saying that amongst gay men, Black men, that actually this study is lower and it's higher in the wider community. So you understand what I'm saying? So you really can't hold fast to these facts. That's all I'm saying. But that's just my opinion. Who am I?
Well, thank you. I appreciate
you're
that.
Welcome.
Danielle.
Yes.
Babe. I appreciate you coming back.
I appreciate being here. This was a good time.
We had a lot of heavy topics, but I'm glad that we had them. You know, we're coming down to the end of the season. We have about six more shows, I believe.
Yes.
Six more shows. The final show, May 3rd.
Okay.
May 3rd.
Three
we
days
need to
before
have a party.
My graduation
I know.
And my
we
birthday.
Need, yeah,
turn
we need
up.
To have a bring in some cake and some champagne.
Still waiting on somebody to get me on TV, so that's where I want to go next. Mm. Pointing at Nikki Curry.
Nikki Curry.
Yes, but Danielle, tell us about everything that you're doing now. I'm so proud of you.
Aww.
I remember when you first came on the show and we had to do the training. Remember you was
talking
to
them
about that?
Oh, yeah, y'all had to talk some sense into me.
Cause
I was like,
so
get your life.
Yes. And now I'm just listening to you. You're speaking. You wrote a book.
Yes, I did. I'm doing a lot. Right now, school has me hemmed up.
You're back in school?
I've been in school.
Okay.
For the last 3 years, I'm at the end. I'm working on getting my license to be a professional counselor. And I've partnered with the Family Wellness and Recovery Center in Norfolk, Virginia, with another beautiful LPC. And we are here tackling these young people. We're working hard to get them together. She has an initiative, Got Mercy, where we're teaching young people about mercy and forgiveness and anti-bullying campaign. And it's a beautiful thing. I really enjoy what I'm doing, but they're keeping me busy. So you don't see me much on social media because I'm out in the streets working with the kids, and I'm really enjoying what I'm doing. And excited to be here because this is something I haven't been able to do for a while.
Right.
So when you asked me to come, I said, okay, let me come
and
represent.
Just
come on in
jump
here.
Jump back into role.
And be Danielle.
Exactly.
I'm real good with being Danielle. So
exactly.
That's what I've been doing with my life and still promoting the book and engagements, book engagements, and speaking to young people and dealing with disabilities because, you know, my daughter has a mental health disability. So I'm still an advocate for that.
Mm-hmm.
And I do seminars and I'm a parent coach and I teach other parents how to navigate through the system and get the things and services you need. So I'm having a good time with life, staying busy. You know, I told you got a boo. So life
got
is good.
Boo.
Yeah, life is good.
That's good.
Yeah,
that's good.
That's the deal.
That sounds great.
Yeah.
Well, Miss Paula B, I already know what you're up to.
Yes.
Your event.
Yes.
Yeah. Tell us about what's going on with Positive Reality.
Well, I had an opportunity to go to the Spring Jam.
Yes, you did.
Yes, I had a great time. Michelet was Guy, Jagged Edge, Drew Hill, Teddy Riley. I was blessed. I had a great time, amazing time. I had a great interview with Teddy Riley and Drew Hill. But what was really cool about it that I'm really excited about that I can't wait for my husband. I'm just put him on blast right now, to put my Drew Hill interview on Facebook because we sang. Everybody knows me that they know I love Broadway. I wanted to be a Broadway dancer, and we sang, what is it called? Song Tomorrow from Annie, right? Okay. So everybody knows that I can't sing, but I sing with everybody I interview. I sing, and they let me sing with them. Will and Nikki do not like to hear me sing.
Yeah.
They don't like it. But the thing of it is that it was like totally awesome because all these people came in a room because we were singing so loud. But the thing of it is that Drew Hill has amazing, impeccable harmony, and I hung in there with them. And they told me that I did an awesome sauce job. And Teddy Riley and Drew Hill were very nice and gracious and did an amazing drop for me for our celebrity cook-off. Yeah, yes, so that was like totally awesome. Mm-hmm. So it was worth it. You know, I was up late. You know, we did our photo shoot for the Kentucky Derby.
Yes, we did.
Let's Talk Fashion, Kentucky Derby style. And I
got on the horse.
I checked something off my bucket list. I've always been panicked. I never scared to get on a horse, but I was bound and determined to do it. Mm-hmm. They had to bring me a step ladder to get up there and kind of push me on the horse. But I got up there, I rode the horse. It was phenomenal. I kissed the horse, let him smell me. So that was like totally a great experience. But the photo shoot was thebomb.com. It was amazing. It was cold out there. It snowed that day. That was last Sunday, right? But right, it was an awesome, awesome experience. So, you know, again, you know, definitely want everybody to come out and support us at the Celebrity Cook-Off Throwdown on April the 8th. Again, the beneficiary for that event is our food bank. This is an awesome time because, you know, there's a lot of families out there that need our support, that are hungry. You know, you'll be astonished at the number of families in the Hampton Roads area that in need of food. So this is the time.
All right. Well, I thank both of you for coming back on the show.
Thank you.
I really, really appreciate it. I just want to end it with a study that I saw that was going on about aging, growing older. And it was basically talking about how the United States people don't deal as well with growing older as other countries do. Over in other countries like China, they give reverence to their older people, whereas we look at it as it's unbeneficial to ourselves. When we get older, we usually look down as being in the way. Usually, people that are older are portrayed in movies as, you know, being a hindrance, being less than, whatever. So I want to ask you guys, how are you dealing with growing older?
I'm excited about it. My kids is going to take good care of me. They don't have a choice. If they won't let anything left in my will, they better take good care of me the whole time I'm here, whether I'm in the way or not. You're just going to enjoy your mama.
So you're growing older gracefully.
I'm excited about it.
Really?
I mean, I think that I'm blessed to be here, and I'm blessed to be able to age. I have had family members and friends who have left well before they've reached their 30s. So to be able to be in my 30s, I'm looking forward to the 40s and the 50s, and I'm going to continue to be Danielle all the way through and until I check out of here. I'm going to be blessed and excited for every year that I get and every day that comes.
How about you, Paul?
I'm loving it. I mean, I always say that I'm very immature for my age, but I'm 57.
You're very lively.
You're right. And everybody thinks that, you know, I'm 57. People think that I'm like in my 40s, which I think is really cool. I am really lively. I like to have a great time. I have a lot of energy. So, you know, it looks good on me, you know, and I wear it well. And I'm young at heart. I always was panic stricken about being old. You know, because you see the people that they didn't look too, you know, they're looking frail. I'm like, I don't want to be like that. But, you know, I keep myself very active. And now that, you know, the kids are out of the way, you know, I just want to go. All of a sudden, I got like this burst of energy. I just want to do everything. I want to be everywhere. I want to enjoy my life, you know, right now. You know, when there's going to be a time when I'm not going to be able to do it. So I'm trying to get it all in now.
Okay. That's a good point.
Yeah.
That's a good point.
Thank you.
Are you enjoying getting older, Raina?
Yeah.
You are? You're looking forward to being an adult?
No.
You're not?
I'm going to miss it.
Really? You're the first That's a kid that I've heard that say that. Mm-hmm. Everybody, I can't wait to get out of my mama's house. Mm-hmm. This is so you get it. Yeah. What about you, Nikki Kara? Are you enjoying the aging process? Growing older?
Yes and no. I'm grateful for the wisdom. Mm-hmm. Grateful for the wisdom that God has given me as to me aging. Mm-hmm. If I knew back then what I know now.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Girl, you better say that like three more times.
Yeah. And a lot of people will not admit that, but Nikki Curry does.
Mm-hmm. That's why I love Nikki Curry.
I know, I life Nikki lessons.
Here I go with my humdrum. So I don't have a problem getting older. I am not enjoying the aging process, and I'm not doing so well, but I have a problem. I don't have a problem with laying on the couch or on the table.
Right.
As long as I'm out, you can do whatever you need to do to get me back to looking top. Optimal
point. Oh my
God. And I have already began that. Uh-oh. And I will continue that until I am satisfied mm-hmm. with myself. So that's my answer. You know, I don't have a problem getting older because the only, you know, other choice is I'm dead. Mm-hmm. I don't want that. But I just don't like things like you were saying, gravity.
Gravity. And yes.
I haven't had a problem with the other thing, but, you know,
oh. Oh.
Lines yeah. and smiling and the crows. I'm not liking that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You have to embrace yourself, though. That's what I'm saying. You have to embrace that.
Yeah,
you know?
Keep all that one. Yeah.
Mm-mm. You said no?
No. As long as I got money and insurance, I get it fixed.
Lord. You are funny.
Yeah.
So there's a fix for it.
Yeah. But I want to thank both of y'all again for coming out. Appreciate you. Mm-hmm. You'll be back in a couple of weeks.
Yes, I had a super blast, as always.
Yeah. Yeah. Thank y'all. And Danielle, you better come back.
I will. I'll be back.
I've been watching you. I'm so proud of you. How can people buy your book?
Oh, Amazon. It's called Life and Lyrics Through Danielle's Eyes.
Yes. Google. And you would love that because she refers to a lot of songs and stuff in music.
Oh, really?
Yeah. It's a cool book. It's doing really good. And I have a workbook that's going to be coming out with next year.
Oh, that's good.
So I'll be going around and doing different trainings with the young people next year after I'm done with the school stuff.
All right. I want to wish you in your 16, new college. And you want to be at 16 what?
At 16, yeah.
Congratulations.
Are you smart or what? You took that after me. Wow. Congratulations. Mm-hmm. And you're going for PR, right? You're going to follow mommy's footsteps.
Yeah, following mommy's footsteps.
Awesome. We expect great things from you.
Yes.
Yes, 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 yes. Yes. So until next week, everybody, be blessed and stay safe.
All right. All right.
Thank you for listening to Let's Face It with Will Strayhorn and Friends. Please be sure to visit us on the web at letsfaceitradio.com and at Let's Face It Radio on Facebook for the latest in show information and exciting, innovating ways that you can be a part of the show. So tune in next week, same place, same time, for real people, real topics, real talk. Let's Face It.